All right. Look with me in Romans chapter 10. I'm going to start reading in verse 19. Let's talk about let's make someone jealous in 2017. Romans 10, beginning in verse 19. Paul is talking about Israel in these verses, and he says, again, I ask, did Israel not understand? First, Moses says, I will make you envious. I want you to just say that word with me, envious. I will make you envious by those who are not a nation. I will make you angry by a nation who has no understanding. Look with me in chapter 11, beginning in verse 1. Paul says, I ask then, did God reject his people? By no means. I am an Israelite myself, a descendant of Abraham from the tribe of Benjamin. God did not reject his people whom he foreknew. Don't you know what the scripture says in the passage about Elijah, how he appealed to the God of Israel? Lord, they have killed your prophets and torn down your altars. Am I the only one left? And they're trying to kill me. And what was God's answer to him? I have reserved for myself 7,000 who have not bowed the knee to Baal. So too, at the present time, there is a remnant that was chosen by grace. And if by grace, then it cannot be based on works. If it were, grace would no longer be grace. What then? What the people of Israel sought so earnestly, they did not obtain. The elect among them did, but the others were hardened. Jump down to verse 11 of chapter 11, Romans 11, 11, if you would. Again, I ask, did Israel stumble so as to fall beyond recovery? Not at all. Rather, because of their transgression, salvation has come to the Gentiles to make Israel envious. Would you say that word again with me? Envious. But if their transgression means riches for the world and their loss means riches for the Gentiles, how much greater riches will their full inclusion bring? I'm talking to you, Gentiles, inasmuch as I am the apostle to the Gentiles. I make the most of my ministry in the hope that I might somehow arouse my own people to envy. Would you say that word with me? Envy, and save some of them. We'll finish our reading there. If we read on in chapter 11, Paul gives an illustration of an olive tree. And he says that Israel was a cultured olive tree. But because of unbelief, the branches of the tree were cut off and wild branches were grafted into the tree. That represents Gentile believers in Jesus. But Paul finishes by saying that God is able to graft the Jewish branches back into the tree again. And we're going to talk about that for a little bit. Let's pray and ask the Holy Spirit to just minister to us. Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for the people that you love so much. Thank you that the fresh fallen snow reminds us, Lord, that you have washed us whiter than snow. Lord, I pray that your heart would just speak to us this morning and that, Lord, we would encounter you through the ministry of your word. If your heart agrees with that, would you say amen and amen? Every one of us who is a believer in Jesus, every one of us who belongs to him was called by him at a divine moment. There was a moment when somewhere deep inside we heard God calling our name and he gave us the faith to respond in that moment. Might have been at a church service when you heard the gospel preached and the presence of the Lord was there. It might have been at a kitchen table when someone told you about Jesus and God's presence came into that moment. Might have been a moment when you were alone. For me, I was all alone in my bedroom as an 8-year-old boy. But wherever and whenever your moment of faith came, there was a process that went before it. God was drawing you to himself. God was softening your heart, preparing your heart. God was awakening spiritual desire within your heart. God sent someone special across your path, and you saw that that person had something you lacked. You saw that that person had something that you wanted. God sent someone to make you jealous. I want us to embark on a mission together in 2017. What if we made it our goal that we would be that special person that God would use to awaken someone in 2017? What if we made it our goal to be a gathering of special people that God would use to awaken many in 2017 and call them to salvation? What if we made it our goal to make someone jealous in 2017? Romans 11 reveals a lot about how God works in human history and also how God works in human hearts. Paul's beloved Jewish people mostly rejected Jesus. Most have stumbled over the stumbling stone, a crucified Messiah. Most have rejected the gospel, but their temporary rejection is all part of God's bigger plan to spread the good news to the entire world. Gentile believers have now come to enjoy the blessings that were promised to God's Jewish people, but they forfeited. And God uses that to arouse jealousy in his Jewish people and so call them to faith in Jesus, the Jewish Messiah. Somebody put it this way: the way God works is kind of like parenting 101. You know, you offer a treat to your son and he refuses it. So you offer it to his sister instead and she receives it and enjoys it. And then your son sees his little sister enjoying the treat that he refused and he gets jealous and he wants some for himself. And that's a good picture of how God works in the world in his family. Looking at Romans 11, I see a few truths about making others jealous, and I want to share them with you quickly. Let's make someone jealous. A few truths from Romans 11. First of all, who shall we make jealous? Who shall we make jealous? You know, sometimes following Jesus can feel like a losing battle in the world. Personally, we're tasting the goodness of the Lord, but we don't see others responding in the numbers that we want to see. We don't see some of our loved ones responding. Paul certainly felt that way. The number of Jewish people who responded to the gospel was just a drop in the bucket compared to the whole nation of Israel. And Paul recalls Elijah's discouragement. He said, "Lord, am I all alone? Am I the only Jew left following you?" But Romans 11 encourages us that God is always doing much more than is apparent to us. God is always doing far more than what we can see, and he will do far more than we could possibly imagine. There are many kinds of hearts that God is working on right now. There are many kinds of hearts that God can and will make jealous through us. So who shall we make jealous? Well, let's make open hearts jealous. Let's make open hearts jealous. Paul says that right now there are some people out there who are ready to receive God's grace. God has chosen them, and they have been in God's grace process for a while already. God has been working on their hearts. God has been awakening spiritual desire. He's been drawing them. He's been calling them, like Nathaniel sitting under the fig tree meditating about the Messiah, like the woman who came to draw water at the well, and she was full of spiritual questions, even though she had a history of very messy relationships. There was a Roman centurion named Cornelius who was reading the scriptures and praying every day, not knowing whether he was doing it right or whether his prayers were being heard. There was a woman named Lydia, a businesswoman, who had a little prayer circle outside of Philippi, yearning to know the Jewish God. There are all kinds of people out there who are ready to receive Jesus. All they need is one divinely orchestrated encounter with you to provoke jealousy. All they need is one meeting with you that has been arranged by God, and they'll see something in you and they'll say, "That's what I want. That is what I have been looking for." All they need is one moment of worship here at harvest time when the presence of the Lord is heavy upon us, and they'll say, "That's what I want. I want to feel what those people are feeling. I want to experience." I can't tell you how many times over the years I've had people say to me, Pastor Glenn, I wish I could have the faith that you people have. I wish I could feel what you're feeling in that moment. And I tell them, you can. There are open hearts out there waiting for you and me, ready right now to be made jealous. But those aren't the only hearts that God wants to reach through us. Who shall we make jealous? Let's make hard hearts jealous. And talking about his own beloved Jewish people, Paul tells us some important things about hard-heartedness. First of all, he tells us that hard-heartedness is only partial. And second, he tells us that hard-heartedness isn't necessarily permanent. It can become permanent, but it doesn't have to be. Paul tells us in these verses that the hearts of many Jewish people have been hardened to Jesus, but they haven't been hardened all the way. Paul himself was one of those hard-hearted Jews, but he came to faith in Christ, and many more Jews came to faith, more than we realize. And Paul says that their hearts are only temporarily hardened. One day, very soon, all of their hearts will be open to receive Jesus. There was one morning that Paul left Jerusalem bound for Damascus with an arrest warrant in his hand. And no one would have ever guessed when he left town that by noon on that same day, he would become a believer in Jesus. Paul hated Jesus. Paul hated anyone who loved Jesus. Someone put it this way, and it's really not an overstatement. Paul was like the ISIS of his day. He murdered Christian men, and he carried Christian women and children off to prison. He seized Christian assets. He put Christians out of business. Paul was a prominent leader in a major world religion. His heart was completely closed to Christianity. His heart was closed on theological grounds, on ethnic grounds, on political grounds, on spiritual grounds. Literally, he was the last person on earth that anyone thought would ever become a believer in Jesus. But all it took was one moment in Jesus' presence. So who is the hardest hearted person you know? Who do you know that hates Jesus and hates people who love Jesus? Who do you know that is so steeped in his own religion that he doesn't want to hear anything from you about Jesus? Among those you know, who is the last person that you think could ever become a believer in Jesus? If you close your eyes and you think about the people you know, who is the last person that you could imagine standing here with his or her arms lifted up in worship? Be encouraged from Romans chapter 11. One day this year, that person could leave his house in the morning and by noontime, he could be a believer in Jesus. You see, his hardness of heart is only partial after all, and it's not necessarily permanent. His heart might have been hard for years, but it's not hard all the way through, and it might not stay hard all the way through his life. God can and will use us to reach hard-hearted people and make them jealous. Who shall we make jealous? Let's make wild hearts jealous. A couple of times in Romans 11, Paul gives Gentile believers a little jab to remind us to stay humble when thinking about the Jewish people. It's highly probable that there was tension in the Roman church between the Jewish and Gentile believers. The Gentiles might have been less appreciative of their Jewish brothers and sisters than they should have been, so Paul kind of jabs them a little bit. He said, "Why should you doubt that many Jewish people will become believers in Jesus? After all, you did. And if God could call a wild-hearted person like you, why couldn't God call the Jews too?" In chapter 9, Paul said that the Jewish people were zealous for God. He said they were conscientious, they were spiritually minded. The Gentiles, on the other hand, did not pursue God. They didn't care about holiness. They lived without a moral compass, pursuing their own passions and pleasures. In Romans 11, Paul calls us Gentiles wild branches. Yet God was able to call us to faith and unite us to himself and to the family of God. You know, it's true that there are more wild hearts than ever before in our society. Sociologists have been tracking the rapid rise of the nones, N-O-N-E-S. That's young adults with no religious affiliation. They're just like the Gentiles that Paul talks about in Romans. They're not pursuing God. They're not guided by a biblical moral compass. They are wild branches. They are wild at heart. But they're not beyond God's ability to call to faith and unite to his family. If God could save wild branches in the first century, he can still save wild branches in the 21st century. God can and will use us to make them jealous if we're the genuine article. Who shall we make jealous? Let's make prodigal hearts jealous. You know, I've been a believer in Jesus for 42 years. In that time, I've seen many hundreds, I've seen thousands of people find faith in Jesus, and I've seen many fall away. But Romans 11 tells us that there is hope for prodigals. Talking about his beloved Jewish people, Paul says that they are branches that have been cut off from God's family because of unbelief, but God is able to bring them back to faith and unite them back into his family. In verse 15 of chapter 11, Paul says that their acceptance of Jesus will bring nothing less than life from the dead. Those are the same words that the loving father uttered when his prodigal son came home. He said, "My son who was dead is alive again." And what was it that caused that prodigal son to have a change of heart in the pig pen? He came to realize all the blessings that were in Father's house. He didn't see it when he was ungrateful and full of worldly lust, but he realized that there's abundant provision in Father's house. He realized there's music and celebration. There's light and warmth in Father's house. He realized there's peace and security and order in Father's house. He realized there's equality and justice in Father's house. Everyone was treated with dignity and with compassion, a far cry from his experience in secular society. Although he was born a son, what caused the prodigal to come to his senses in the pig pen was jealousy over the servants in his father's house. He said to himself, "Even the servants in my father's house are treated better than the world has treated me." Beloved, listen to me. Receive this word from the Lord. Don't write off the prodigals. They might have left in an ugly way. They might have gone far, far away. They might have been away for a long time, but don't write them off. God is able to awaken their hearts again and reunite them with Christ and with his family. When I go to teach at the School of Acts every year, I always finish with a question and answer session with the students. I let them ask me anything and everything. I don't answer everything, but I let them ask. One of the questions that I always get is, "Pastor Glenn, what has been your greatest challenge in ministry?" And my answer is always the same: people leaving. You know, my dad left me on my 16th birthday, and that left a little bit of a hole in my heart. And even though people leave for many different reasons, I take it personally when people leave, like a rejection. And when people leave, I tend to write them off. But as I was praying over these verses, the Holy Spirit spoke to me, and he said, "Glenn, don't you ever write off the people that I haven't written off." And beloved, there's a word for all of us there. Let's not write off the people that God hasn't written off. Hard-hearted people, wild-hearted people, prodigals who have written us off. God alone, who searches the hearts of men, knows what we don't know. He knows that the prodigals that are out there have just about had their fill of the world, and they're jealous for what they're missing in Father's house. God can and will use us to make prodigals jealous. Who shall we make jealous? Let's make Jewish hearts jealous. There are many practical applications for us in Romans 11, but we can't forget that this chapter is first and foremost about God's Jewish people. And what he teaches about the Jewish people is that they are not beyond faith in Christ. They're not beyond being provoked to jealousy by us. Jesus, beloved, is Jewish. The very first believers in Jesus were all Jewish. The apostles, they were Jewish. Paul, the apostle who brought the gospel to the Gentiles, was Jewish. In every New Testament church, there were significant numbers of believers, Jewish believers in Jesus. In every century of church history, there have been Jewish believers in Jesus, more than we realize. There are many Jewish people right now ready to come to faith in Jesus. And Paul writes in chapter 11 that as human history draws to a close, there will be a tremendous number of Jewish people coming to faith in Jesus Christ. You know, sometimes we're intimidated to share Christ with our Jewish friends, as if they're much harder to reach than anyone else. But I want to tell you that thinking is not in alignment with the Word of God. Paul is telling us here that if God can call hard hearts and wild hearts and prodigal hearts to faith in Christ, he certainly can and will call Jewish hearts. And he wants to use us to do it. I want to say that here at Harvest Time, we have a very unique opportunity to reach Jewish hearts, much more than most other churches that I know. For one thing, we happen to live in a part of the world where there is one of the highest concentrations of Jewish people, more than 2 million in the New York metro area. Second, we have an unusually large number of Jewish believers in Jesus right here in our congregation. And third, we're blessed to partner with our friends at Messiah's House to help us learn how to intercede for Jewish people and how to share Christ with them. And I really believe that what's in store for our future is something very special with regard to Jewish and Gentile believers in Jesus worshiping here together. Last September, I had a dream of our first service in phase two, and the guest speaker was a Messianic Jewish rabbi. And I knew that the rabbi was Jesus himself, but it's significant that he came as a Messianic Jewish rabbi. I believe that God's plan for phase two is for scores of Jewish people to come to faith in Yeshua, the Messiah, right here. I really want to encourage you, if you haven't connected yet with Messiah's House, that meets here every month, I want you to connect with them in 2017. They're meeting this Friday evening. They meet one Friday night a month during the Jewish feasts. They always do special celebrations that bring out how Christ is portrayed in every one of the Jewish holidays and the Jewish feasts. But this Friday evening, Grant Barry is going to be sharing his testimony, how as a Jew, he came to be a believer in Jesus Christ. And if you haven't connected with Messiah's House yet, I want you to connect with them this year, because God wants to use us to make Jewish hearts jealous. Let's make someone jealous in 2017. Few truths. Who shall we make jealous? Second, what will make them jealous? What will make them jealous? Romans 10 and 11 tells us that God's desire is to use us to provoke jealousy, but what specifically about us will make them jealous? What will they see in us that will make them hungry? What will they see in us that will make them say, I want that, I need that? Well, Paul says that the blessings that were promised to Israel and pursued by Israel were not obtained by them, but they have been obtained by us by faith. So what are those blessings of Israel that provoke jealousy? A few things I find. First of all, God's fiery presence with us. God's fiery presence with us. When God called Abraham, he said, Abraham, don't be afraid. I will be with you. And God appeared to Abraham as a burning lamp and as a smoking furnace. God appeared to Moses as a burning bush and then as a fiery cloud and a fiery tornado. When Solomon dedicated the temple, God's fiery presence came and filled the temple so that the priests couldn't stand up and minister anymore. When Elijah called on God at the time of the evening sacrifice, God answered him with fire from heaven. On top of a mountain, Jesus' face began to burn with fire. His clothes began to burn with fire, and he was enveloped in a cloud of fire. After Jesus' resurrection, 120 believers gathered in an upper room, and the fire of God appeared in that upper room and sat on each one of them. And the fiery presence of God has been with us ever since in the person of the Holy Spirit. When we gather to worship, his fiery presence is here. When we speak under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, when we tell people about Jesus, the fiery presence of God comes into that moment, and even unbelievers feel it. When we lay hands on people in Jesus' name, even unbelievers feel the fiery presence of God, and it provokes jealousy among those whom God is calling to faith. Something inside of them says, that's what I need. That's what I want. What are the blessings that provoke jealousy? Another thing I find is our forgiveness and our freedom in Christ. In Galatians chapter 2, Paul says when he visited Jerusalem, the Jews there were jealous of his freedom in Christ. How could Paul be so confident? How could he be so secure? How could he live outside of the law and yet so fulfill the spirit of the law? How could he experience all of this? It provoked them to jealousy. And beloved, forgiveness and freedom in Christ is still powerful to provoke people to jealousy. To those whose souls are stained with sin, the relief of forgiveness is attractive. To those who have struggled to break free from the bondage of sin, the promise of freedom is attractive. To those who have labored under the heavy hand of religion, trying to earn their way to heaven and please God, the free grace that comes simply through faith in Jesus is attractive. It provokes people to jealousy. What are the blessings that provoke jealousy? Another thing I find is uncommon fruitfulness. Paul gets a little playful here in Romans 11. He says that God grafted wild olive branches into his family, and they bore good fruit contrary to nature. Now, the Roman Christians knew immediately that Paul was saying something ridiculous. What Paul was suggesting is precisely the opposite of what happens in nature. Wild olive trees do not produce useful fruit. The fruit is small, it is bitter, it is inedible, it is completely unusable, it is garbage. When a horticulturalist grafts a branch from one tree into a different tree, the branch will yield whatever type of fruit that belongs to that branch. So in other words, if you graft a nectarine branch into a peach tree, it will not bear peaches, it bears nectarines. If you graft a wild olive branch into a cultivated olive tree, the branch will not bear good olives, it will bear wild olives that are useless. But Paul says that something happens when Jesus grafts us into himself, and when he grafts us into God's family by faith, something supernatural happens. And even though we are wild by nature, in Jesus we produce uncommonly good fruit. We blossom into something beautiful that we previously were not. Even though we're wild by nature, in Jesus, we produce the fruit of a loving heart and a loving personality. We produce the fruit of a joyful spirit that the world cannot rob us of. We produce the fruit of a peace of mind and demeanor. We produce the fruit of patience. We produce the fruit of gentleness, of good behavior, of faithfulness, of meekness, of self-control. Control the beauty of Christ in us, that uncommonly good fruit coming out of a wild branch like us provokes jealousy in hard and wild and prodigal and Jewish hearts. What are the blessings that provoke jealousy? Another thing I find is God's favor with us. God told Abraham, "Don't be afraid, Abraham. I will be your shield and your very great reward." The favor of God protected Abraham everywhere he went. The favor of God prospered Abraham everywhere he went. The favor of God enabled Abraham to persevere until he realized the fulfillment of every promise God had made to him. And the favor of God does the same thing on our life. It protects us and it propels us forward in life and it prospers us. Do you know what the favor of God looks like? It looks like a little church that once acquired a piece of land for $1.5 million, half of the asking price, and a year later got offered $6 million for the same piece of land. Sometimes I regret that I didn't take the money and run. It looks like a church that built a $4.5 million building for $3 million. And when it was time to build again, the town zoning laws temporarily changed in its favor so they could double the size of the new building. It looks like a church building a $24 million building for $12.9 million. You know, as the building is getting more and more complete, I've had local pastors calling me. They're coming to see me. They're coming to see the building. And I want to tell you, they're jealous in a good way. Their faith is inspired because they realize if God could bless a bunch of wild branches like us, then he can bless anyone. What are the blessings that provoke jealousy? Another thing I find is God's family. You know, the funny thing about social media is that the more that we're connected to it, the more disconnected we become from one another in real life. And people are hungry for community. They're hungry for family. Jesus talked in John 15 about the good fruit we would produce in him, but he said, this is the one that would make people sit up and pay attention. This is the one that would provoke jealousy, our love for one another. No matter how wired up the coming generation might be, God knows how we're all really wired inside. He knows what we really need and what we will always need, and that is his family. What might happen if we made it our goal to be the family in 2017 that makes people jealous? What if we made it our goal to love one another and serve one another and care for one another in such a way that when people come, they see what we have and they say, I want that. I need that. Let's make someone jealous in 2017. A few truths. Who shall we make jealous? What will make them jealous? Finally, this. How will we make them jealous? Worship team, you can come help me finish. How will we make them jealous? I want you to listen. Listen and catch this. In verse 13 of Romans 11, Paul says, I make much of my ministry so that I might make people jealous and save some of them. What does Paul mean by that? What he means is I apply myself to my ministry to make it the best it can be. I do the things that need to be done to make my ministry dynamic in the spirit and effective in order to provoke people to jealousy. I fast, I pray, I spend time in the presence of God, I study his word, I worship, I keep my life unspotted, I do all of those things, I make the most of my ministry, I make it everything it can be so that God can use it to provoke people to jealousy and to save some of them. What if we made that our goal in 2017? As individuals, what if we made it our goal to make the most of our walk with Christ so that God could use us to provoke jealousy in the people in our life? And as a congregation, what if we made it our mission to make the most of our church so that we could provoke people to jealousy? How do we do that? How do we make the most of our ministry? I'll give you one final thought and we're done. We make the most of our ministry, ironically, by staying humble. Paul reminds us that the only way that we've been united to Christ and his family is by God's grace through faith. God chose us to be recipients of his grace. We didn't do anything to deserve it. We didn't do anything to earn it. Otherwise, Paul says, it wouldn't be grace. Don't become proud and think it was something you did. That's the opposite of faith. That's self-reliance. Don't think that because of the blessings you've received that you're somehow better than people out there who are hard of heart or wild at heart or who have prodigal hearts. If the good cultivated olive branches were temporarily cut off because of pride, how much more will the wild olive branches be cut off if we become arrogant? Faith is humility. It's trusting in Christ and his cross alone for our salvation. And when we humbly trust him, we stay firmly united to him and his life flows through us and we produce uncommonly beautiful and attractive fruit. We receive God's kindness and we're kind to others, and that is something that the world just cannot resist. Let's make someone jealous in 2017. Who shall we make jealous? What will make them jealous? And how will we make them jealous? By humbly trusting in Jesus. Would you stand together with me? And would you give the Lord a great big praise this morning?